Boston, you're my home. That's for all of us this morning.
RadioOrNot.com and SoFloRadio.com present The Nicole Sandler Show.
Truth to power, baby.
And now, here's Nicole.
And welcome to a Tuesday. Oh boy, here we go. I'm Nicole Sandler coming to you live at Radio or Not, SoFloRadio.com, TalkRadio1.com, and yes, our newest stream, video stream at YouTube.com/Nicole Sandler are all up and running this morning. And wow, I'm not quite sure where I was, what I was doing when I heard the news yesterday that there had been two explosions at the Boston Marathon. You know, it was interesting because I was, I do remember that I was looking on Facebook and I saw a lot of people were posting about the marathon, that they were out there, watching the coverage. In Boston Marathon, one of the oldest and most, best known marathons in the world, that happens on Patriots Day every year. Yeah, Patriots Day, which is a holiday in Massachusetts, because, well, of course, it's Massachusetts. And, you know, so initial, and so, and then all of a sudden, I started seeing the posts on Facebook about explosions. Mike M. in the chat room says they seem to have someone in custody now. I always keep one eye on the Twitter feed where, you know, which seems to be, the most immediate source of news these days. And I'm not seeing anything about anyone in custody yet. Now, the, it's interesting that yesterday, I had to call a bunch of people out for posting links to a story from the New York Post. Not only the New York Post, but of course the fake news channel, Fox News also echoed it, and the Wall Street Journal. These were the sources that were telling us, one, a Saudi national was in custody. Not true. The guy who was being questioned apparently was a Saudi national. The Wall Street Journal told us five unexploded bombs were found. Not true. What else? They were the source of such misinformation. And again, I tweeted, I posted, I emailed, wait for a real news source. The New York Post and any organization that is under the Murdoch umbrella does not count. Now, Dave Ajean on Twitter just said, Boston PD says they're refusing to discuss who they may or may not have in custody. So, I know they just had a press conference, another update. So, now here, this just came out. Two and only two explosive devices were found yesterday. Other parcels in area of blast have been examined. No unexploded bombs. But, you know, once again, all of the misinformation seems to be coming from, from the Fox sources, from the Murdoch sources. They are disreputable. You cannot believe anything that comes from the New York Post or Fox. And I have a hard time saying Fox and News back to back. Or the Wall Street Journal, which is really a shame because that used to be a reputable news source. I mean, for a while there, it was after Murdoch took over. It was, you know, it was just, well, just don't read the op-ed page. But now, even their so-called news is wrong. They were reporting five unexploded devices were found. Now, Nora O'Donnell just tweeted, more than 150 injured in Boston bombing. Authorities say, quote, two and only two, end quote, explosives were found at scene, just in from special briefing. Gotta tell you, this morning, not wanting to, you know, tune into the morning joke, because that show gets worse and worse and worse with each passing day. I did tune in to CBS because I heard as I was out and about yesterday that a lot of people who I respect were saying that Scott Pelley over at CBS was doing the best coverage. You know, CBS has this new morning show with Nora O'Donnell, who I've always liked, and Charlie Rose, who's awesome. And I got to say, thankfully, I turned it on and I was sort of in and out of the coverage this morning. I didn't see Gail King, you know, Oprah's best friend. It's amazing how being somebody's best friend gets you a job these days. But they were doing some really good coverage. Unfortunately, I turned it off the minute Nora O'Donnell promoted that Rudy Giuliani would be coming up to talk about how a city deals with, you know, a disaster, tragedy like this. Sorry, don't need to hear from Giuliani either. Of course, you know, the right wing jumped on President Obama almost immediately for because he didn't use the word terrorist in his address to the nation last night. Here's a little bit of what he said last night.
We still do not know who did this or why. And people shouldn't jump to conclusions before we have all the facts. But make no mistake, we will get to the bottom of this. And we will find out who did this. We'll find out why they did this. Any responsible individuals, any responsible groups will feel the full weight of justice. Today is a holiday in Massachusetts, Patriots Day. It's a day that celebrates the free and fiercely independent spirit that this great American city of Boston has reflected from the earliest days of our nation. And it's a day that draws the world to Boston's streets in a spirit of friendly competition. Boston is a tough and resilient town, so are its people. I'm supremely confident that Bostonians will pull together, take care of each other, and move forward as one proud city. And as they do, the American people will be with them every single step of the way. You should anticipate that as we get more information, our teams will provide you briefings. We're still in the investigation stage at this point, but I just want to reiterate, we will find out who did this, and we will hold them accountable.
You know, I have no doubt we'll find out who did this. You know, and part of me says, I hope it's not this Saudi national. Did you? Because only because, of course, it's going to beef up the rights. Some guy named Eric Rush, and I'm sorry, I don't know the Fox personalities. I can't watch or listen to their bullshit. But apparently, a guy named Eric Rush yesterday tweeted something, you know, about, you know, them damn Muslims. And then someone says, what, you're blaming this on them? And he said, yeah, we should kill them all. Nice, right? This is a guy who works for Fox. Well, apparently he took the tweet down, but you know what? It's the interwebs, and anything you put up there lives on forever. There is such a thing as as a you know, screen grab, and people took them. Boston Globe just tweeted out that the Boston Police Commissioner said the number of injured is 176. 176 victims total, 17 people in critical condition, 3 deceased. That's unbelievable. It's unthinkable. It's unconscionable. And it's not that I'm hoping that this is domestic terrorism. But honestly, look, it's that time of year. This is the time of year that those fucking right-wing crazies come out. Patriots Day, in Boston and other cities. It's Patriots Day. It's just a holiday in Massachusetts. I believe it was Patriots Day the day. And I'm sorry, this is speculation, and I normally hate speculation, but I'm putting it out there as such. I don't know anything. But, Boston Police Commissioner Ed Davis just said no one is in custody. That's a quote. Okay. Obviously, I don't know anything, but the fact that it's Patriots Day, I believe that the Oklahoma City bombing was also on Patriots Day, although I think that was on the 19th or the 20th. Shit like this tends to happen in this country this time of year. Yesterday was Tax Day, Patriots Day. I know on the 19th and 20th, this is just a weird time of year. For me, honestly, I prefer to celebrate 420, which in another more peaceful manner, that's coming up on Saturday. Just the whole idea that somebody would plant bombs to go off as, you know, a lot of the runners were crossing the finish line. An 8-year-old boy is dead. People have been dismembered. We're hearing stories of limbs that were just blown off. Some of the witnesses reported hearing or seeing body parts flying, blood everywhere. It's just stunning. Washington Post just tweeted out, Boston press conference has concluded. Here's what we know. And hold on, I'm waiting for the page to load so I can give you the latest. From the Washington Post. Boston woke Tuesday morning to grief and unanswered questions as investigators searched for the people who detonated two bombs near the finish line of the venerated Boston Marathon, lifting runners off their feet, killing at least three people and injuring approximately 140 others. So even, you know, look, right after the briefing, all the information we're getting is different. Follow along for the latest updates. Police, no one is in custody. Here you go. Boston police, 176 injured, 17 critical. Police and FBI are asking for any information. They're asking that people use 1-800-CALL-FBI or go to the FBI's website. They're asking for any images or video. They said no piece of information is too small. They're saying they're looking for any information. The thing is, this was along Boylston Street, very busy roadway in Boston, there are video cameras everywhere. We might not realize it, but there are. All the ATMs have video cameras. There are, you know, video cameras surveilling the streets. I don't know for sure what's in Boston, but there are a lot of video cameras at work. And hopefully they'll get video of somebody who threw something in both of those trash cans. Apparently they were in trash cans. I'm not going to spend too much time on this today because we don't know a whole lot. But I can tell you, you know, it's Tuesday. That means Gotta Laugh joins us in the second hour. And, you know, Laffy has twin sons. Laffy's sons are both in college. They're identical twin boys. They're not boys anymore. They're young men. One of them, you might remember a month or so ago, was I think in Fullerton, California. I'm forgetting, you know, there are so many damn lockdowns on college campuses where there are gun incidents. But one of them was in one of those colleges that was locked down because there was a crazy person with a gun running around. That was just a month or so ago. And yesterday, her other son, who attends Tufts University in Boston, was in a restaurant right in the vicinity of the finishing line of the Boston Marathon. And that's how, and Laffy just popped into the chat room and said, I'm still shaking. The first report that Gotta Laugh got of the bombing was when her son called. At least he had the presence of mind to call you immediately. So you knew that he was okay. But I can't imagine knowing that, you know, two bombs had gone off and your son is in the area. I can't even imagine the feeling. So Laffy will join us. She spoke with her son. Her son is safe. He's okay. He called again once he got to a friend's house. He broke the story. So we'll talk to her about that. I got to say one last thing that just so stunned me. But nothing surprises me anymore. I'm fed up with people. There are some really fucked up people in the human race. It should be drummed out of our race. And of course, Alex Jones, you know, and his ilk are pushing this meme that it was, what do they call it, a false flag attack? Basically, their contention is, oh, this was done by the government so that they could justify increased security around the country. Really? You believe that? You can go fuck yourself. And so I was on Facebook and some person, look, I've got a lot of Facebook so-called friends who I don't know because I do a radio show. And so, you know, I have people who I've got a lot of people who are Facebook friends who I've never met. And sure enough, I see one of them this morning posted something along the lines of, I wonder if I was the only one who immediately thought false flag when the Boston bombs went off. And thankfully, there were a lot of comments under this asinine statement that told this woman she was an asshole. And what I added to it, you've now given me good reason to unfriend you. Goodbye. And because I'd like to clear out some of these non-friend friends and have everybody go over to the Facebook page at The Nicole Sandler Show. And I can have my personal page, you know, for friends, but whatever. Not important to me. What is important is that, that we debunk the false information, most of which, you know, came from Fox. And now, of course, the scare tactics coming from Alex Jones and those nut jobs. Anyway, there is other stuff going on, although, of course, our attention is mostly on this. We'll take a quick break and come back on the other side with Cliff Schechter, who was supposed to be in Washington, D.C. today for a protest against the NRA. But, you know, a lot of this it goes hand in hand. So Cliff Schechter joins us next. Got a laugh in the second hour with her son's firsthand account of what he witnessed, what he felt on Tuesday morning. A lot of discussion, important discussion coming up on the show this morning. So stick around. I'm Nicole Sandler. It's radio or not.
Why is Google hanging out in Bermuda? I'll tell you today on Hightower Radio. We just had a presidential election in which an admitted tax dodger advocated lower taxes on corporations and speculators like him. And voters rejected that idea and him. Also, polls show that about 7 out of 10 Americans think corporations should pay more in taxes than they do now, and that loopholes allowing corporations to dodge their taxes should be plugged pronto. Yet, a tiny percentage of Americans, the CEOs of huge multinational corporations, are demanding that Congress do the exact opposite of what the people clearly want them to do and instead enact those special corporate tax breaks that last year's presidential loser pushed. Whose side is your member of Congress on? You'd better check, because the corporate powers are pushing furiously for a deceptive gimmick called the territorial tax. It declares that the profits of U.S. corporations can be taxed only by the territories in which they're banked. Google is one of the giants that are hot for this scheme, for it stashed 80% of its 2011 profits in Bermuda. That's $9.8 billion Google got, not from sales in Bermuda, but from customers elsewhere. Yet it banked all of the money in this tiny territory that essentially doesn't tax corporate profits. Thus, the nifty territorial tax is Google's way of paying no U.S. income tax on those profits to support the schools, police, research, transportation networks, and other public systems that allow it to flourish as an American corporation. This is Jim Hightower saying, worse, This territorial scam is an incentive for multinational corporations to shift more of their operations and jobs out of country and to rig their books so all profits appear to be earned offshore. To learn which corporations are behind this, contact Citizens for Tax Justice, ctj.org.
If you'd like more of Jim Hightower's real populism, check out the Hightower Lowdown. Jim's monthly newsletter gives you the real lowdown on which corporations, by name, are doing what to the middle class, our environment, and our democracy. Each month, the Hightower Lowdown brings you facts you didn't know, along with actions you can take to fight back. It also comes with a sense of humor. Hightower believes we can fight the gods and still have fun. Plus, get this, it's cheap. Only $15 brings you 12 issues a year. For real populism, go to HightowerLowdown.org.
The George Rodriguez Show.
Who?
I said the George Rodriguez Show. You don't know George Rodriguez?
Wasn't he the guy that filled in for Neil Rogers?
Yes, that George Rodriguez.
What's he like?
Oh, he's a short little Cuban feller, kind of funny looking.
Well, when's he on?
12 to 3, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday on SoFloRadio.com and SoFloRadio.net. The George Rodriguez Show is much more than
adequate.
Oh, boy. All right. The George Rodriguez Show follows my show, weekdays 12 noon Eastern at RadioOrNot.com. All right. Interesting because Stefanitza in the chat room, whom I, who I usually agree with, said, I think true skeptics should always be open to the possibility of false flag operations. Sorry if that puts me in the sick tinfoil hat wearing crowd. And I wrote back, it's like, really? I'm sorry. That's just crazy. Setting off bombs in crowds of innocent people. Don't you think that's a bit far-fetched? And she said, I don't think this was, but I still think we need to be open to the possibility. Is it impossible to believe that our government could harbor some sick fucks? No. I don't. And I do, I guess, look, I have questions about 9/11. Do I think it was an inside job? No. I can't put anything past George W. Bush. And as much as I'm not a fan of Obama's these days, I don't see this happening. I don't see it under him. I know. I do think that this was likely domestic terrorism, but I don't know anything until we get a definitive answer. I don't know. All right, let's get Cliff Schechter on the line, shall we? Because Cliff Schechter is, we were going to talk today about guns because there was the possibility that today.
Hello.
Good morning, Cliff Schechter. Cliff Schechter, a media maven, a co-owner of We Act Radio, a PR pundit, a PR guy from Libertas LLC, an author, a columnist. You're just like an all-around Renaissance man, I guess.
Or I'm just not really that good at anything, any one thing, so I do lots of them.
No,
that's the alternative.
You're real good at all those things.
thank you. I appreciate
yes.
it.
Anyway, so it's great to have you here, Cliff. On such a weird, weird day. Now, you were supposed to be in Washington, D.C. today.
That is correct. We were going to be conducting a march on the lobbyists for the NRA. Obviously, with things occurring like they did in Boston yesterday, and I'll be quick to offer my condolences to everybody involved, who were there in Boston, because having been in downtown Manhattan on 9/11, I know how traumatic that can be just being there. Obviously, just that the march we were going to do wasn't going to go forward in that
right.
way, out of respect for the people there and in deference to what happened.
Well, and by the same token,
it will happen in the future. Yes. I will tell you that.
Right, and by the same token, a lot of the political activities have been sort of suspended, as happens at times like these. Look, I was supposed to have Howie Klein on for a little bit in the first half hour to talk about a Blue America contest there. Having for people who for congressional candidates who have who are running against the chain CPI as part of their platform, and
right,
right? And so But I thought, you know what, we'll put it off till tomorrow because today is not the day for that. It's that's just, you know, I don't know. I think it's just such a, we're all still just a bit shell-shocked.
Yeah, well, I mean, and that's it, you know, and obviously we've dealt with, you know, again, I'm sure there are people who are dealing with it, some of the look, you know, from the look of what happened and the cell phones being down and everything is a reminder for many of 9/11, and there's dealing with that trauma. There's obviously, you know, what you and I were going to talk about, what happened in Newtown, which is still a huge trauma for people, and of course some of the Newtown families were there
right
at the Boston floor, which is just, I mean, at some point you just shake your head and just say, come on.
Right. Now let's talk about that for a second, because
the world, frankly,
they said the last mile of the marathon was dedicated to the Newtown survivors, and a lot of the families were in like the VIP stands right at the finish line. And initial reports were, we, you know, there were a lot of us wondering, oh my God, can you imagine if something something more happened to these people? I don't think that they could take that. I certainly couldn't take that.
No, nor could I. You know, again, I can deal with a certain amount of understanding the world is an unfair place. But my gosh, you know, I mean, that's too much to bear. So I don't know. All I can do is, you know, offer what everyone else does, hope and prayers, and just hope that everybody, that they're okay.
Right.
And frankly, just having been there, I'm sure will be a terrible, terrible thing.
Right. You know, the a story just crossed. I've been hearing about this one of the heroes in a cowboy hat who apparently rushed into the crowd of injured people to help people. And I find out that I know this guy. His name is Carlos Arredondo. He's from South Florida, and his son was killed in Iraq in 2004. And when he found out about it, he set a van on fire and hopped inside and, you know, like tried to kill himself. I mean, the guy went crazy. And
wow.
Right. And so I had him at the time. I was hosting a morning show here in Miami on WINZ. And I had him on my show. And what he did, though, when he came on, I guess it's there is that line between, you know, letting people help you and alienating those who are trying to help you. And he like drove up to the radio station in like this a car decked out as a hearse, and he put like tombstones in front of the radio station, the entranceway, and like people were really freaked out and pissed off, and it was like, hey, you know what, I'm putting you on the air to try to help you. And then
right.
He got, you know, when I asked him, I said, you got to take that stuff down, he got all belligerent and stuff. But now look, there he is in helping people. Apparently, he was comforting some guy who lost his leg. There's a picture of him holding together the femoral artery or a tourniquet on a victim who had lost both his legs in the attack. And the quote was, I kept talking to him. I kept saying, stay with me, stay with me. He told the newspaper up there. Wow.
Well, you know, maybe there's some redemption for
yeah,
him.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not that something like this should have to happen for that to occur, but I would hope in his case that maybe this was a way, you know, he could channel his grief into helping, into something more productive and helping other people.
Yeah.
Because I certainly understand, I mean, you know, I've not been in that situation, but I mean, the impulse, I do have kids, and I mean, I don't want to imagine the thoughts of what I would think of learning what he learned, so I can't even bring myself to say it, quite frankly. So
right.
I understand, I guess, is what I'll say. And
right.
It doesn't mean you don't have a responsibility to handle it in a way that's not dangerous or threatening to other people.
Exactly. Right. I mean, look, this was a radio station with, you know, 8 radio stations in the building, and people didn't know what I, you know, what this was
right,
about.
Well, you
and
guys
it freaked
hadn't
them
done
out.
Anything, and it
no.
wasn't, I mean,
That's
it's threatening to you, and that's
yes.
that's never acceptable under
no,
any circumstances.
No, exactly. Anyway, so you know, it just shows how our actions affect others. But there he is, you know, being touted as the hero yesterday for helping victims. So I'm glad to see that. You know, obviously.
You know, speaking of that, I don't mean to cut you off, Nicole, but I want to ask something. I might as well ask it on your radio show.
Yes.
Which is, I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know what, you know, this stuff. But look, we all have rights. We're going to talk about some of the restrictions that are completely reasonable on the Second Amendment today. Well, I wonder, you know, I'm not a lawyer again, but what are the reasonable restrictions that are on the First Amendment, quite frankly? Something that, as somebody who is a writer and a speaker, I believe very strongly in, as I know you do, which is the right to free speech. But and when it gets, you know, we do have clauses, we do have things about inciting riot. You know what I mean?
Right.
Yelling fire in a crowded theater.
Exactly.
At what point, I just want to ask this question honestly, at what point does Alex Jones's behavior cross that line?
Yeah.
And get to the point where he's actually putting people's lives in danger. He's
right.
Encouraging attacks on people and on the President of the United States. I really would like to ask that question because there has to be a line somewhere where free speech turns into terroristic threats and turns into inciting riot. And I've never fully understood because it seems like it's used sometimes, but not other times. But I mean, he's now blaming the White House for this and claiming that they're responsible for this.
Right? No, he's saying this was a false flag operation, and oh my God! And then there are others on Facebook who are parroting this. Really? I mean, isn't that treason?
That's what I'm saying. And he has an audience. People on Facebook are bad enough. That's one thing. But this guy has an audience and he has influence on people. Isn't that yelling fire in a crowded theater? Isn't that? I'm sure there are plenty of lawyers who listen to your show. And I've got plenty of friends who are lawyers who I'll end up talking to about different things today. And I'll find myself asking them. But for anybody that's in the chat room or whatever, I'd like to know your thoughts.
Because I really
am interested at what point. Do these people need to stop? At what point when they're getting police officers killed?
Right.
You know, like what happened in Pittsburgh because of people like Glenn Beck and the NRA and others claiming with these far fringe theories about the government coming to kill you and Obama coming to take your guns and three police officers who just are showing up on a routine warrant and are being shot and killed because this guy is scared that he's heard that Obama's coming to take his guns. You know, I really do want to know because these people are endangering all of us, and I'd like to know at what point it's no longer free speech. You know, I mean, where does it cross that line into you are threatening people? Because they're getting people killed. That's quite clear.
Right.
They're speaking to large audiences of angry, paranoid, well-armed people. So when is that their responsibility?
Yeah, I don't know.
I'd like to know what people think, though.
Cliff, here's the line, because I was sort of thinking out loud as I mentioned this Alex Jones nonsense. I understand some of the truther arguments, but only because I've spoken to scientists who have concerns about Building 7, and there's no reason Building 7 should have collapsed. All right, so there's at least some scientific reasoning to go there. Whether you think they're nuts or not, there's at least something there. There's Architects and Engineers for Truth, this organization. And I've spoken to some of them who said, first of all, heat, intense heat that even brought on by jet fuel and in a plane going into a building, even that kind of heat will not bring a building down. And besides the fact, Building 7, there was no reason it should have come down at all. I understand there are legitimate questions there. But this? Where does that come from? There's nothing there. There's no there other than the sick, twisted mind of a paranoid hate monger.
No, I agree. And look, when it comes to the any of the truther stuff, I'll say I haven't spoken to any of these people. I've never seen what I believe to be credible evidence that there could have been any government involvement in that. I respect if you've spoken to some of these guys and they've offered that view
and
science behind it.
And there's no proof that it's government involvement, but just that there are questions to be raised about how these buildings came down.
Fair enough, and that's fine. I just want to be clear. I've never seen anything that I think is credible beyond that there was a terrorist attack that day. But then again, even the guys you're talking about, I don't follow all, you know, and I'm sure there are different truther groups and whatever.
Yep.
I'm not sure who it is. You know, there are some people that are talking about it in a more open-ended way. There are others that are scientists or whatever. I've never seen anybody that I'm aware of who sat there and said, you know, I have evidence that this was a false flag operation by George W. Bush. Now, maybe some guys have said that, and I would say that that's just as ridiculous, because you don't go out there and make charges when you don't have credible evidence. You can, you know, I mean, you can speculate, and I'm happy to even speculate on this, but I'll be very clear to say I have absolutely no evidence if I have no evidence.
Right.
You know what I mean? I mean, look, I'm not going to sit there and be cowed into silence and pretend to be stupid. This was on Patriots Day in Boston, on tax day.
Yep.
With crude IEDs that have been compared to the ones that blew up at the Atlanta Olympics.
Wow.
Of what we know, that these things were put along the Martin Luther King Day march in
Sacramento,
Washington.
Oh, was it Spokane? Right, right. Yes, exactly. That's what all things point to. Yet, Cliff, I need to share this with you. I don't watch Fox, so I don't know who Eric Rush is, but apparently he's a commentator on Fox.
The Kill All Muslims guy?
Yeah. So yesterday, Eric Rush tweets, "Everybody do the national security ankle grab, ! Let's bring more Saudis in without screening them. Come on, with a hashtag Boston Marathon." And then somebody, Bill Schmalfelt, tweeted back to him, "Eric Rush, sweet God, are you already blaming Muslims?" And Eric Rush responded, and his Twitter handle is Blood on the Mic, "Yes, they're evil. Let's kill them all."
Okay, so let me say again what I said earlier, to reiterate it. At what point this is not a private individual.
Nope.
If he's a Fox News contributor, he goes on TV, he presumably has an audience. At what point has he now crossed the line into where he should be talking to the FBI, quite frankly? At what point has he made terroristic threats? Has he incited riot? Again, I'm not a lawyer, but I'd like to know that, because to me it seems like that's exactly what he's doing.
He's saying kill all the Muslims? Holy shit.
I'm sorry?
He's saying kill all the Muslims. Yes, let's kill them all.
Yeah, he's using his platform to do that. And I think that, I mean, again, you know, that's when you do things like that in this kind of a situation, in this kind of an atmosphere. And of course, let's be very clear. There is no evidence that anybody who's a Muslim was behind this, as there's no evidence that anybody of any other faith or anybody else in this country that I know of yet was behind it either. All I'm saying is, if I'm going to speculate, if I'm going to sit there and play detective, I'm going to look at the facts that you know, they were celebrating on Monday. Friday the 19th is actually Patriots Day.
Right.
They're celebrating it on Monday because federal holidays, you often move it to a Monday.
Right.
And the 19th, of course, is when Timothy McVeigh attacked Oklahoma City. So when you add up the IEDs and you add up the Patriots Day and you add up tax day, I'm talking out loud here as just an individual who has no evidence. But yeah, I would be lying, and I'm not going to sit here and shut my mouth and say that I'm not suspicious, because I am. I'll also be very clear to say, as I just did, that I have no evidence, as I have no evidence that it's anybody else. But to immediately, you know, to immediately say, oh my God, it's Christian extremists. Oh my God, it's Muslim extremists. Oh my God, it's Hindu extremists. Kill them all, is so utterly ridiculous. I don't know how public figures can get away with that. I really don't.
I don't either. Now, apparently, I haven't seen this yet, but boy, Media Matters is working overtime this morning, because apparently on the right, these people are going nuts. So Laura Ingraham, let me just play a little clip from Laura Ingraham, her show from, I guess, this,
joining us
this
now,
morning.
Congressman Mike McCaul, chairman of the House Committee on Homeland Security. He joins us now in the Boston terror attack. Congressman, it's good to talk to you. Look, we will stay out of the politics here.
Really?
But I would ask you, do you get a briefing, or will you get a briefing today on this?
Well, yeah, I did yesterday. I talked to the White House, was briefed federal, state, and local law enforcement on the ground, and then I'll be talking to the Secretary this afternoon. But to comment on that piece... you know, look, we look at the blood in the streets and this little 8-year-old child, Martin, who was killed as he's running to embrace his father. And to politicize this that early on, when there's, you know, we're cleaning the blood off the streets, for God's sakes, is one of the most offensive things I've heard from Chris Matthews. And, you know, I've been very careful when I've spoken about this that, while it is clearly an act of terrorism, and it has all the hallmarks of that, and that being simultaneous bombs going off, mass casualties, spectacular event, I've been very clear to say it's important not to jump to conclusions, that we don't know who the perpetrator or the motivation, what that is. and that it could be either foreign or domestic.
Well, Congressman, I will say that Nick Kristof, writer, New York Times, and you know, been around for a long time reporting and commenting, he tweeted yesterday that shame on Senate Republicans for not confirming the head of the ATF, that somehow linking the failure to confirm a head of the ATF.
You know what? I don't want to listen to her anymore. But apparently she used the Boston bombing to stoke fears about immigration reform.
She's a wonderful, wonderful person, and she really must be proud of how she's used that education of hers to further the dialogue in this country. I guess that's all I can say is I just hope one day she looks in the mirror and it looks back at her and tells her what a terrible, terrible human being she is. Beyond that, Nick Kristof's point is exactly right.
He's
on.
Right.
Again.
Right.
And again, I'm being more careful than I would normally be here because I still do feel like this is the day afterwards. But I fight a three-letter organization, as you know, all the time.
Yes.
That stokes fear among these very types of violent and unhinged people. And that three-letter organization, I'm sure most of you can figure out there who I'm talking about, mm-hmm. has made sure that since 2007, nobody has been running the ATF, which is the organization that is involved with tracking explosives, not just guns, and the illegal sale thereof. They have made sure to cut that organization's funding constantly. They have made sure to come up with false allegations and false scandals. And even when there are real mistakes made, like there were in this so-called Fast and Furious operation, one that was started under a previous president, by the way, that they were all too happy to love, that they try to turn it into some kind of a conspiracy beyond just the mistakes that were made. This is what they do all the time. By doing that, by passing these T-Hart amendments that don't allow the ATF and certain other bureaus of the government to make information they have public, to share certain information, they've done everything they can to block the sharing of information. They've done everything they can to hamper this organization that's tasked with protecting us, to hamper their ability to function. And in fact, they even referred to them at one point as jackbooted thugs. Which led former President George H.W. Bush to resign from this said three-letter organization in disgust.
Right.
So, what Nick Kristof did is exactly right. I mean, you would think that the one thing we could all come together on, you know, whatever your beliefs are, is that the organization that's tasked with going after people that are illegally trafficking and things that can kill us would be given all the tools necessary, including someone running the damn organization. You would think that's the least we could do.
Yep.
There are now people that are objectively, for their political agenda, putting our lives in danger.
Right. Now,
just all there is to it.
I hear you. Now, Cliff Schechter, a couple of other things. Yesterday, and I opened the show pretty much talking about this, a couple of things. I spent way too much time yesterday responding to tweets from people who were citing a report from the New York Post and the Wall Street Journal and Fox. Those were the only organizations that kept talking about this Saudi national supposedly in custody. Or, and five other unexploded devices found. All of it is now totally debunked. There were two, they say, and only two bombs. That was it. And now, apparently, the Boston Globe just said the Saudi national is not, but the Boston Globe said that Saudi national who was an injured student who had nothing to do with the bombing. He's been
I guess the biggest joke of all of it is that I saw the New York Post thing, and I guess they just care if they appeal to a certain hardcore crowd.
Right.
So they don't care about they don't care about their credibility to the broad audience, but if they do care about that at all, I didn't even take it seriously. I mean, it didn't make me think twice that there was any accuracy to it.
Right, but I had to
people. That's my response to that.
Let me know when a credible news source says something. The New York Post, anything owned by Rupert Murdoch is not a credible news source.
You should pretty much look at it this way. You ever walk into a restaurant and there was a table that was there before you that had kids? And as my kids often do, and there were kids' menus there and there had been crayons, and the kids had been drawing and writing things on them. Anything you see in the New York Post, you should treat with the same amount of credibility.
Right.
If you do that, then I think you'll find yourself in good shape
for
looking at the world's events.
Exactly.
Because that's about the level of credibility you're talking about.
Now, I just saw another tweet, but I have not seen confirmation of it anywhere, that a U.S. Airways flight at Logan Air Force at Logan Airport in Boston had been was surrounded by police.
I haven't seen that yet, and if we find out more about that, I'll be interested in that.
Yes.
But again, you know, right. I still remember, you know, a good friend of mine who wrote a great book on Oklahoma City named Andrew Gumbel, who's written a number of books, been terrific books, wrote about, you know, what happened there and how first it was a gas leak, and then it was Muslim terrorists.
Right, right.
And then it was,
yep.
I remember on 9/11 that we're doing reports, you know, a car bomb went off outside the State Department. You know, the Sears Tower has been taken down. I mean,
right.
I remember hearing a number of these things that day.
Yep.
We all have to keep in mind what goes on, and particularly, you know, when you've got communications that are knocked out, they turn, you know, sadly in the situation we're in with modern technology, when people can set off bombs with cell phones, which is apparently what occurred here, they just shut down all cell phones in Boston. So only some information gets out, not all information gets out. All it takes is one bad source,
yep.
you know, to
That's
feed
it.
Information. And then suddenly a guy that was a U.S. senator was giving money and speaking to friends of Hamas, right? I mean, honestly, that's all it takes these days, isn't it?
Yep.
So let's all, you know, keep in perspective what we hear and be very sort of, you know, and again, I think if you're responsible about it and you are very quick and clear to say, look, there are a couple things here that make me suspicious, which is what I just said, yet I have no evidence to prove that,
exactly.
and so I can't come out and say it, then that's fine. And I don't think that there's anything wrong with that. I think there is something wrong with it when you start blaming specific individuals or specific groups when you absolutely don't know.
Right, exactly. And that's how I've been prefacing everything I've said, what it appears to me to sound like. But again, I don't know anything yet, and that's why we need to be really careful. Cliff Schechter,
exactly right.
Since I have you on the line, and we were going to talk about guns, there's not going to be a vote today in the Senate. But two things I want to ask you about. One is, I had Alan Grayson on the show this time yesterday. He was on with me for a half hour. We talked about a lot of things, mostly the whole chain CPI bullshit and the disappointment
yeah.
in this president for suggesting it, you know, that whole thing. But I did ask him about this gun legislation that is now going to be debated in the Senate. And I said, on the, you know, far, you know, the idea that perhaps it does get through the Senate, what's going to happen with it in the House? And he said nothing. Because it's not going to go anywhere in the House. So there's one question for you. So
yeah.
how do you respond to that?
Well, it's hard to argue with Alan Grayson.
I know.
He's a big guy. I think he can beat me up. No, I mean, and
it's just not because of him. It's because of, you know, the right wing obstruction.
No. I just meant his analysis of the situation.
I know. Right.
From what I've heard that there are some. There's a number. You know, Peter King is on the right side of this issue.
Mm-hmm.
Can be on the wrong side of other ones. There's some other Republicans that are, too, that are whipping and trying their best in the House. I've heard that it can go either way, as it can in the Senate, that there are enough, because there are a number of suburban type Republicans. I mean, if you're just talking about New York and New Jersey, where there's about four or five of them, and Pennsylvania, the suburbs of Philly, you've got 8, 10, 12 Republicans right there that are in districts that literally, in polling, one of them, Congressman Chris Smith's district in New Jersey, 100% of people were in favor of background checks, 100%,
right. Wow.
Not 99.
Yep.
So, you know, but again, if this doesn't pass, then I guess we just have to fight that much harder, because it just, the thought that what happened in Newtown happened and they could pass nothing is so sickening. It just makes the stench of that, of the corruption in that place. It sometimes makes me want to give up, and yet, you know what it does? It actually, I think about that for a couple of minutes and it makes me want to fight twice as hard. Because they're not going to get away with this.
Right, but now
I'm
I've got
to make sure whatever small amount of power I have, I'm going to make
good.
Sure that if they don't, whoever it is who refuses to pass this, whoever those people are, they better be in the most right wing possible districts. Because if they're in anything else, they should be prepared for 2014.
Okay, but now, Cliff, here's the other question, and I wasn't aware of this until this morning. You know, Got a Laugh joins me on Tuesdays. In the second hour, and I'm going through, she sends me a bunch of stories that we should talk about, that the stories that she's covered from the week, and she has a piece up there, a video of a guy named Alan Gottlieb. Do you know who he is?
Second Amendment Foundation.
Foundation. And he is speaking at a gathering of right-wingers. And I want to play for you, and it's a little lengthy here, and I may stop it at certain points, but I want you to hear what he's saying. Basically, he's saying that he was in the room with Joe Manchin and Pat Toomey, as they wrote this bill, and that he got a lot of stuff put in there. And basically what he's saying is, you know, we got him because this is a pro-gun bill disguised as a background check bill. Listen to this.
If we talk about it too much, the other side's going to find out about it, and they're going to realize we're going to win off this thing. The background check bill there is not even a universal background check. It's at gun shows, commercial venues, or the internet. And, to be candid about it, it doesn't cover family members of any kind, or your friends, or any gun transaction.
We know that,
the gun
right?
show or basically
right?
on the internet.
Right.
But here, listen to this.
There's protections. If you do go through the background check, you as an individual will now get both civil and criminal liability protection that you don't have now. If somebody sold a gun to somebody and they misused it, nobody can sue you, even in civil court, for damages. That's great protection that you don't have right now.
So did you hear that part?
Yeah, I did.
Okay. It continues. Let me play
That's
more.
That's one of the other important things in there. Traveling across the country, it gives you more protections with your firearm for people to take your gun from state to state than you have now. Another important one, you cannot now legally buy a handgun in the state that you don't live in. If you're not a resident of the state, you can't buy a handgun. Under the so-called background check bill, you'll be able to buy a handgun in all 50 states. As long as you buy it from a licensed dealer, you can buy it from anywhere you want. There's a million other checks in there. It's a Christmas tree. We just hung a million ornaments on it. We're taking the background check and making it a pro-gun bill. Unfortunately, some of my colleagues haven't quite figured it out yet because they weren't sitting in the room writing it. My staff was. I'll be perfectly candid about it. This will probably break on Monday in the Wall Street Journal. So you're getting a little bit...
Okay, so he said to be candid, but the people don't know it yet, but they weren't in there writing the bill. My staff was. We put all this stuff in there, and we're making it a pro-gun bill.
Yeah, I've heard this before. I heard this yesterday, and I'm, you know... I'm not fully sure how to react to it because in the case of Alan Gottlieb, he said lots of things before.
Right.
And not all of them have turned out to be true.
Right.
To be charitable, a lot of them haven't turned out to be true. So, he's a foundation to raise money for. It really benefits him to say they weren't in the room, I was in the room, and to play up his role in the whole thing.
Right.
And no doubt there are a couple things on the pro-gun side of the ledger in this bill that I don't like. But like with any piece of legislation, it's never as good as we want it to be, and you need to look at everything overall. Whether someone who's living here in Ohio buys their gun here in Ohio or next door in Indiana, I don't know if I'm going to trade that and see that they have to go through a background check, that seems like a pretty good deal as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
It's not perfect. This thing's far from perfect. We're not even talking about assault weapons and these high capacity magazines, which should not exist
right.
in and a civilized society for regular people to be able to get a hold of who can do so much damage in so little time.
Right.
This thing isn't near good enough, but that doesn't mean you don't support it. You know, it doesn't mean it won't improve things. Background checks, I will tell you, everybody wants to make out like criminals are people who are criminally inclined are geniuses. They're not. Most of the time, if we cared to look,
right.
we would catch them.
Right.
If the records had been shared, and you know, this is to let's say today, the 6th anniversary of Virginia Tech, the killer at Virginia Tech had been adjudicated mentally ill and dangerous by a county, one of the counties in Virginia, by a judge. He should have never, if that record had been shared by Virginia with the national database, he should have never gotten a gun. Jared Lofter had been determined by the U.S. Army to be a habitual drug user, another banned category. He's somebody that never should have been able to get a gun. I mean, right. these are two things that right away that should have been preventable. Columbine,
yep.
lack of background checks. So we can go on, and it's not, you know, the point is that if you improve the background check system, and this isn't universal background checks, he's right. Alan Gottlieb's right about that. It's short, far short of what we want. But internet sales are where a lot of this stuff goes on.
Sure.
Gun shows are where a lot of this stuff goes on. It's a lot better. It gets to places where people can sell mass numbers of guns to people. You know, I mean, yeah, can you call your neighbor and he can meet you with 50 guns, I suppose, or whatever? I mean, but that happens a lot less than somebody showing up at the places that have supplies of them, like the internet and gun shows. And so, you know, we have to all weigh that stuff and do what we think is best at the end.
I
would say good. Supporting the bill by far is the better option here.
Okay, good. And I'm sure you and, apparently CBS is saying that police surround U.S. Airways plane at Boston Logan Airport. I will have to look into that again because that
you know. Could be somebody trying to escape. It
yep.
could be a variety of things.
Yep,
so
it could be. Up, okay, WFXT TV. Two men removed from this says American Airlines flight at Logan Airport. So now this is, you know, something's happening at the airport. Okay, so we'll keep an eye on that. Bloomberg, LaGuardia Airport terminal evacuated due to suspicious package. Two men, according to one TV report, removed from a flight at Logan. So,
Let's hope that one's accurate.
Yep.
And hope that they've got them.
Yep.
You know,
wouldn't that be great? Yes.
Well, if they can do that in 24 hours again, it's amazing.
It is amazing.
And, you know.
Yep.
If we give these guys, again, to bring up what we talked about with the ATF, we give these guys the tools to do what's necessary. And now I'm talking about what's legal and what's constitutional, not the extra constitutional
right.
tools that we give other groups of law enforcement to use on people that haven't done anything wrong.
Exactly.
Well, that's the amazing thing about all this. We will hinder the efforts of the ATF to protect us. However, when it comes to certain things like enhanced interrogation and listening in on phone calls by certain other organizations, go right ahead and do it. It's amazing. It's really rather amazing.
It is amazing. The IRS can go through your email and, you know, other stuff like that, which what I said yesterday is why not just rescind the Fourth Amendment if they're going to go that far? And this is another topic for another day. Not that I'm endorsing that idea. But, my God, if they're saying that, you know, the IRS can go through our email and, you know.
I didn't even know that. Where did that come out?
Just Google IRS email. And you'll see, it's just in the last week or so, this story.
In other words, if they suspect that you're cheating on your taxes,
I guess.
See if you actually send an email like, hey, I'm cheating on my taxes.
No, or, you know, a question to your accountant, let's do this. I was going to send email my accountant a legit question that I have. That might be, you know, sort of right on the line of, can you do this?
Not that I want to break the law. You can do something.
Right,
I mean,
right. And
that's what you do. You ask your accountant, was this legal? They say, no, you can't do that. And you say, okay.
Right.
If we didn't have such a stupid system with so many, you know, loopholes and so crazy, we wouldn't have to ask our accountant 50,000 questions.
That's right. I know. I agree. Here again, NESN, which is the New England cable network, breaking.
Yeah.
FAA confirms U.S. Airways flight 1716 stopped at Logan Airport.
Wow.
Something's going on there, so we'll keep an eye out for that. So, Cliff, I mean, in the last minute or two we have together, what is the latest on the gun legislation? Do you have any idea when the vote might happen? It was supposed to be today or tomorrow. Now it's obviously.
No, I'll be honest with you again, not having because everything just happened yesterday. Right. I haven't heard yet, so I don't know. I mean, there may be others out there that know better than me, even because I was. Having planned this event in Washington yesterday and having to unplan it, which involves, I've learned almost as much as planning something. I've been so busy with things and whatever that I haven't even gotten to that. So I'm not sure. My guess is that they would try for this week or the latest next week, but I don't know for sure yet. So people will have to just keep monitoring and so if we find out and there's things to discuss, I'm happy to come back on if you want me to. And we can
absolutely
talk
we will
completely about that and not about
right.
about this.
Well, yeah, I mean, it would be amazing if we got some closure on it today and they really figured out who was behind this, so all the speculation can end. That would be wonderful. We'll see. We'll keep everyone posted on it. And Cliff Schechter, we'll continue the conversation. Thanks so much for coming on with me this morning.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
All right. I will talk to you later. Cliff Schechter. Follow him on the Twitters at Cliff Schechter, at Cliff Schechter. And I'll have links on the blog at radioornot.com. All right. Let's find out what is happening. For the news, we turn to the Talk Radio News Service at talkradionews.com. Good morning. Who's on the line today?
It's Ellen Ratner, and I'll tell you, well, Washington is very much sort of, I wouldn't say on lockdown, but certainly on secure down.
And people
are very freaked out about what happened in Boston. Of course, no one really knows who the perpetrators are. There's a lot of speculation today. The Senate and House Intelligence Committee are getting a special briefing. People are sort of afraid to say it's foreign terrorism. They're also afraid to call it domestic. My view is that everything is terrorism, whether it happens at Sandy Hook or whatever, because
you're
people
right.
get terrorized.
It's
go
terrorism,
outside.
Right. And the question is, who is perpetrating this terrorism on us? Is it a foreign entity? Is it domestic terrorism? This time of year, Patriots Day has historically been, look, it's the anniversary of Oklahoma City
Waco.
And Columbine and Waco and
Waco, right.
I'm sorry, Virginia Tech. I mean, all of that is this week. I'm just seeing reports of a U.S. Airways flight that was stopped at Logan Airport, and somebody else tweeted that two people were taken off the plane, but a friend of Susie Madrick, who's the managing editor of Crooks and Liars, said they were overheard speaking Arabic, probably not anything. If they stopped a plane because two people were overheard speaking Arabic, I'm going to be sick.
Absolutely crazy.
It's like this kid yesterday who was injured in the blast, who happened to be a student but a Saudi national, and he was, you know, not taken into custody, but the police took him to the hospital and were interrogating him, and they searched his apartment, and it turns out there's no connection there because he was a Saudi national. I mean, I'm sorry, it's disgusting. And if this turns out to be
totally disgusting.
Yeah, and if the reason this plane was stopped is because two passengers were overheard speaking Arabic, I'm really going to be sick.
Well, I certainly don't blame you. I mean, it's just, you'll be sick, I'll be sick, we'll all be sick.
Unreal.
It just is crazy.
Oh, my God. All right. So what do we know? What are you covering today?
All we know is that there was, quote, unquote, a Saudi national who was there on a student visa who was running from the scene. But everybody was
running from the scene.
We know that they have looked into a house in Revere, Massachusetts, on the water. That's, again, all we know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We know nothing else.
Right. We do. But I think we know that it was his house because his roommate is speaking out and saying, wait a minute, I know this guy. He's my roommate. This is not. Sorry.
Right.
Yeah.
So, I mean, my guess is, if I'm a guessing person, they're probably not going to find a whole lot there.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, people get very suspicious, just like the person on the plane.
Right. Oh, God. If that's the case, I'm sickened. What do we know? There was an explosion of sorts and a fire at the JFK Museum in Boston. At first they said it was connected, then they said it wasn't, then they said it might be. Do we know anything?
We don't know anything more about that as well. If I'm a guessing person, having lived literally, I mean, my office was a block and a half from where the first explosion went off yesterday.
Oh, my God.
It was on Dartmouth and Commonwealth, and just really two streets over, street and a half over, because the back was on Newbury. So really, you have a situation where, you know, there could have easily been a problem at the JFK Library, having nothing to do with
right.
it.
Right, right.
I mean, with a new building, you know what happens often with new buildings.
Uh-huh.
We just don't know.
Right. I guess a lot of this, you know, it's going to take a while to figure out what's going on. Now we're seeing live video being posted and pictures coming from Logan Airport where they've surrounded this plane.
Ah, oh my gosh.
Wow.
And who knows what it's going to mean.
Right. Could be nothing.
I mean,
LaGuardia Airport Central Terminal evacuated due to suspicious package. And meanwhile, my boyfriend is flying home today from Dallas. I told him, you better get to the airport really early because...
right, because they're going to be inspecting everything like they did when the liquids thing came
yep.
through. It took like an hour and
yep.
a half.
Yep. Oh, yeah, yeah. It's, you know, this, it is just a mad world. And you have to, it's times like this. I guess, you know, Patton Oswalt, who's a comedian, posted something under On Facebook yesterday to try to bring things into perspective, in which he said something along the lines of, you know, when at times like this, when you think the whole human race has gone crazy, you got to remember that these crazy people are such a tiny, you know, fraction of a percent of, you know, like this is not who we are. These are the crazies. These are the nuts. They are not us. And so you can't lose faith with humanity. You know, I saw on Facebook yesterday, I kept seeing pictures of Mr. Rogers, and I couldn't understand why. And finally, I clicked on one of them, and it's all his quote about, you know, when he was a little kid, and he would get scared about things, and his mother told him, well, when something bad happens, focus on the helpers. And that's what people were quoting yesterday and posting on Facebook, which I found very comforting.
One of my concerns, Nicole, is really what if we have this bill that is coming up before Congress on guns?
Yeah.
What is this going to mean in terms of the issue of, well, this terrorism was not done with guns. So therefore, how are guns going to prevent terrorism? Well, you and I know it's just one piece of that crazy puzzle.
Exactly.
But that doesn't mean that they're not going to kind of use it as an excuse.
Well, of course. Well, they'll try anything. So what? Because this time it wasn't a gun. It means, well, don't worry about the guns. We'll just outlaw bombs. You know, it's those stupid, you know, look, there was I think it was in Texas just last week where somebody went on a stabbing spree, right? Guess what? None of those people died. There were 25 people injured, but nobody died.
Right.
Yeah. You know,
I think that's what's going to happen, and they don't have the 60 vote to get some of this where they need to do. And of course, in the House, it could die pretty easily.
Yeah. Oh, of course. Well, and I had Alan Grayson on the show yesterday. He was on with me for about a half hour, and I asked him, so if this gets through, if it gets through the Senate, what's going to happen to it in the House? And he said nothing. And then he explained because of, you know, what goes on the right, but his quick answer was nothing. It will die in the House.
Oh, what can I say?
Yep.
It's really, the president was very careful yesterday when he spoke, which I was glad about.
Right.
You don't want to jump any guns. And some people were really jumping guns.
Right. Oh, my God. And on the right, they're nuts. First of all, you have who's that moron, Alex Jones, saying it's a false flag operation, basically saying the government did this. You know, how he is allowed to keep broadcasting, I don't know. You have Laura Ingraham, who's basically saying, well, this is all because of the immigration, you know, reform that's coming. I mean, these people are just the guy. Do you know who this Eric Rush guy is at Fox? I know you do some work for Fox. You
heard no, I don't actually.
Well, you know, he said, now we need to pick up more Saudis and search them all. And then somebody said, are you blaming Muslims? And he said, yeah, we need to kill them all. They're evil.
Oh, my gosh.
You know.
Crazy, no. Right?
And meanwhile, in D.C. now, all the flags are at half staff, which that just happened in the last, you know, few minutes.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yep. Yeah. All right. Well, the president is going to speak at 11:30. And I guess, you know, this takes precedence over everything. I mean, this is what Americans are.
Well, I'm glad the president is, you know, addressing this.
Yep.
I think we need some calm, and I think the president is in sort of a unique position to actually do that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just, what can I say? I'm pretty astounded.
I'm astounded too. Wow. And again, this flight, it's a U.S. Airways flight. They are unloading the passengers and the luggage, and they're searching everyone. I'm stunned.
I hope it's on some basic information and not racism.
I hope so too. If this is only because two people are speaking Arabic.
If you are a
if you're a terrorist and you perpetrated this, I don't care whether you're American or not.
Oh, right.
What I'm going to do is to get on an airplane. You should probably make your getaway by car.
Right. I mean, I agree. But again, if the only reason they stopped this plane is because someone said, oh, my God, they're speaking Arabic, I think all hell will break loose, as it should.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we'll see.
All right.
Okay. Just a couple other interesting things. Very interesting case before the Supreme Court today. And that has to do with adoption. I know this is something that's very near and dear to your heart. A child was adopted that was like less than 5% Indian, but then his Indian father reclaimed him, or her Indian father, I can't remember. And the question is adoption rights, the American Indian law that would prevent people just taking Indian children, versus, of course, the issue of the best interest of the child.
Right. And in this case, though, this was a the father was absent, was not in the picture, right? The adoptive
right.
couple adopted this baby at birth 27 months ago. This is over 2 years ago. The baby is, what, 256th Cherokee? I mean, seriously.
Right.
And now the birth father is coming forth saying, wait a minute, I didn't approve this adoption and took the child. I'm sorry. This is insane. So this is being heard by the Supreme Court today?
It's being heard sort of as we speak. It's probably just over right now. Of course,
wow.
We're not going to have a decision for quite a while.
Right. I could see if the child was, you know, one quarter Cherokee and the father was the, you know, the Cherokee and maybe and lived on, you know, on the reservation and it was, you know, really then perhaps. But this sounds crazy, you know, and you know, the right wingers question Elizabeth Warren's heritage.
For sure.
Yeah.
That's kind of scary. What I mean? What do you say?
Yeah, I don't know. Hey, right. What? Yeah, are all the? Yeah, I know you do reports for a lot of, you know, conservative talk stations. Or are they all freaking out over the gold plunging?
A little bit. I mean, we've really heard. I mean, actually, believe it or not, most of the conservative stations are being very careful about, unlike Alex Jones,
mm-hmm.
about jumping to conclusions.
Well. And Laura Ingraham, too, she said, you know, is aligning this with immigration reform.
Right. I don't know where they're going on all of this, but I can tell you that the right wing is being pretty darn careful today.
Yeah.
As they
Good.
Say.
Well, they really should be. State police may involve a piece of luggage. All right. I'm looking at a live stream from CBS Boston. Security incident, Logan, involving flight from Philadelphia. Oh, this was a flight from Philadelphia. All right, I'm going to keep this screen up so I can keep following along. In the meantime, Alan Ratner, I'm sure you want to go. It says, may involve piece of luggage that was not checked.
Oh, my gosh.
All right.
This is the kind of craziness you get after all of this.
Yeah, I know. Nuts. And the interesting thing, this is a flight to Boston from Philadelphia? I don't know. All right, it looks like the live stream just ended.
Yes, I'm supposed to fly out of Boston on Friday. We'll see you
there. Well, be careful.
Thank you.
All right. Ellen Ratner, thank you so much. Bye. Ellen Ratner from the Talk Radio News Service. They're at talkradionews.com. Oh, boy. Nutsy, crazy stuff. All right. We'll take a break. Come back on the other side with Gotta Laugh from thepoliticalcarnival.net. You need to know, Laffy has a personal stake in this. One of her sons, she's got identical twin sons, both in college. One of them attends Tufts in Boston, and he was at a restaurant right near the finish line, right near where the bombs detonated yesterday. Inside the restaurant was part of the commotion and the craziness. Luckily for Laffy, he called her. He broke the news that this happened, and it was just right after she hung up with him that she started seeing the reports on Twitter. We'll find out from Gotta Laugh exactly what her son told her yesterday. And we will check in and hear the president's address at 11:30. So stick around. Back with Laffey in a moment. It's Radio or Not.
This is the Media Matters Minute. I'm John Kerr. Members of the right-wing media have engaged in a campaign to pressure the mainstream media for providing what they term insufficient coverage to the murder trial of Dr. Kermit Gosnell. Here's CNN's Aaron Burnett.
There are many people out there, as you're aware, on the right who are saying, look, it's pro-choice people on the left who aren't going to covering this story because they're pro-choice and this hurts their agenda. It's such an awful, horrific thing. It'll make people more adverse to abortion. That's bad for them, so they're not covering it. What do you say to those people as someone who reports on this issue?
And Eric Bowling on The Five.
There's another murder trial underway that isn't getting much attention in the press. It involves the murders of seven newborns. The capital murder trial of Pennsylvania Dr. Kermit Gosnell.
But while Burnett and Bowling suggested that media on the left may have failed to cover the trial of Dr. Kermit Gosnell for political reasons, neither had previously covered Gosnell's story. For more on this and other stories, please visit MediaMatters.org.
Hi, friends. This is Tom Hartman.
This is Stephanie Miller.
Hey, this is Hal Sparks.
I'm Brad Friedman. I approve of Nicole Sandler's RadioOrNot.com.
Radio or Not.
Radio or Not.
RadioOrNot.com.
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 Hey, kids. It's time for the political carnival. And gotta laugh with the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, boy. All right. This is the time of week. Every Tuesday morning, we speak with Gotta Laugh from thepoliticalcarnival.net.
Yes, you've reached the moms who need a Valium hotline.
Hi, moms.
Hi. Press 1 if you think being a worried parent is the number one cause for alcoholism.
Yeah.
Press 2 if you think we not only need gun control, but we also need bomb control, panic control, and irresponsible reporting and tweeting control.
Yeah.
Press 3 if you want to join me now because it's 1 o'clock and I don't care who knows it.
Yes. That's wine without an H.
Exactly. W-I-N-E. Let's keep drinking.
Of the Pinot Noir variety. I noticed you're a Pinot fan, too.
I am.
Me, too.
I
boy, in San Jose, Laffey, you and I are going to drink some Pinot.
Oh, that sounds so wonderful. Can we start now and just catch up later?
God, yes. Oh my God. So, okay. All right. Now, yeah. I'm watching. I've got different screens up on all the various computers I have going during the show. I have the WBZ TV, the CBS affiliate from Boston, streaming live on one computer, because they were just showing pictures of the this airplane that was stopped at Logan Airport. Now, Susie Madrick tweeted of Crooks and Liars tweeted to me that two men were overheard speaking Arabic on the plane. And oh my God, if that
I
was
bet
it.
People were overheard speaking English too.
Yeah, you think? But the web crawl on the bottom of the screen at this TV stream that I'm watching said that this may have involved a piece of luggage that was not checked.
Oh, okay.
So, but it also said it was a flight from Philadelphia to Boston. So who knows? Boston police are saying no one is in custody at this point. They're reshowing one of the press conferences. All right, I don't need to watch that.
Well, you know, there's so much speculation. That's what drove me crazy yesterday. And, you know, it drives me crazy every time there's a big story that breaks. And unfortunately, I get caught up when you read all these tweets and they're all saying the same thing. And you're going, really? Wow,
right.
Really? Wow.
Right.
And I've learned over the time that this has happened and over the time I've been on Twitter to take those with a grain of salt until something really credible comes along, or to at least, as you said earlier, to sort of couch it, or maybe it was Cliff, to couch it in speculation terms. Like,
right.
it's being reported that, you know,
right.
Nothing is confirmed yet. But so many things were coming out yesterday, and I decided, you know what, I'm not going to speculate. I am simply going to print, you know, post news stories that are confirmed, that are up there.
Right. By the way, I need to break in because Will from Chicago in the chat room just posted from CBS Boston, police security incident on plane at Logan, not related to Monday's bombing. Okay.
There you go.
Yeah, that's why you never know. Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. And just like, you know, the first thing I saw was on Twitter about, you know, this plane being surrounded. And I tweeted to the, because the person who tweeted it out just said reports. And I wrote, reported by who? Reports is not good enough. You know, and then this is shows how things spread. So, all right.
Exactly. No, it's absolutely true. And in fact, okay, so going back to my son breaking this news, he literally broke it seconds before I saw one tweet go up about it. And when he called me, it was ridiculous. He was in a bar. I'll explain how he got there in a minute, but he was in a bar and it was so noisy in there. I have never heard any call come through my headset as noisy as this was. I couldn't hear him.
Oh, boy.
And I thought he said, I ran a marathon and what's going on or something. And I said, what do you mean you ran a marathon? You don't even run. You know, and I was like, what are you talking about? And then I realized what he was saying. And then he said explosion. And I said, wait, what? What? And then right when he was saying this, I said, wait, let me tweet this and see if anyone knows about it. Right when I was about to tweet, in fact, I was tweeting it, but then I stopped because I saw somebody else. So what happened was, I'm just shaking talking about this. He had been at the finish line, but then they left the finish line.
Oh, my God.
And he was at a restaurant. It's called, I wrote it, you know, from this, he did a couple of interviews yesterday, a Max Brenner restaurant.
Okay.
I don't know anything about Boston, so forgive me.
I love Boston. It's a great town.
I've been there once, but it was so long ago. Honestly, I just remember I loved it, but I don't know any of the, you know, landmark, you know, small landmarks like this. Anyway, they were in the restaurant and he heard what he thought was something falling. When he explained it to me on the phone, he said it sounded like something really heavy fell. And he couldn't figure out, well, you know, and nobody was really that concerned. It was like a huge bam. And then he started kind of looking around and people were looking curiously around. And then the second explosion sounded like a pop. And at that point, everybody suspected, of course. You're hearing the same stories, by the way. I was watching TV yesterday. Everyone is saying the exact same thing I'm telling you now. Everyone. I mean, it's amazing how everyone, the first one was like, everybody's confused, and it didn't really sound like that, but it could have sounded like this. And then the second one, everybody went, whoa, what's going on? Mm-hmm. And he said everybody around him in the restaurant started panicking and running out the door. And I was saying to him, by the way, if you're ever in this situation again, do not run with the crowd. Make sure you know what you're running toward.
Right, right.
And anyway, people were headed toward their back. There was a bathroom and there was a rear entrance. Ugh. And so that was their choice. He had sort of a group leader at his friend's crowd at the table, and his friend was saying, let's go in the back. And they were, unfortunately, I don't know if they were breaking fire laws at that restaurant or what, but he said there was all kinds of chairs in the way. Aye. He didn't know what was going on with all these chairs that were blocking the exit. But anyway, they finally got through to a back alley and they made their way down to a bar. Well, I kept asking him, how close were you? And he couldn't answer me until like 5 hours later, because he doesn't know his way around Boston either, and he didn't know how to tell me where he was. It turns out, he says, and I'm quoting him, we were two businesses away from the second explosion.
Oh, my God.
Well, don't even ask. Anyway, so they went, they ended up at a bar, and he said they were feeling pretty good because they had escaped whatever danger they felt they were in. They felt that they had escaped from. Until all the TVs were tuned into the news, and he said they were blasting these TVs so loudly that was disconcerting all by itself. Then, of course, the level of the noise in the room raised up, which is why I couldn't hear him. But he said it wasn't until he started watching the news reports that he got really freaked out, because he realized what had happened at that moment. For the time being, it was something weird happened. We escaped from it. We're safe. Yay, us! You know, then it hit him. And then they tried to get home and they couldn't get a cab. And so they called cab companies. They tried everything they could, no transportation. So they walked several miles to their friend's house, and he ended up having a car where he could drive them to one of the other friend's house.
Mm-hmm.
And that he finally called me at 3 o'clock. It was later than that, but it was sometime in the afternoon, our time, when I finally found out he was safe.
Right. Wow.
Not on the streets.
Oh, my God. So your son goes to Tufts?
Yeah, he's finishing up in May.
Wow. How does he go to Tufts and not know his way around Boston?
He knows his way around Boston, but he's has the worst sense of direction. And I kept saying, well, I'm looking at the TV screen and there's these tall buildings. Are you near them? You
know, oh, God.
I think he was just freaked out. And
I'm sure.
He kept asking, what street? I don't know what street we're near.
Oh, God.
My kids, don't ask. They're really, really smart kids. But so sometimes they're just sort of in the dark.
Now, you know? It was just like a month ago that your other son, where does he go to school?
At Cal State Fullerton.
Fullerton.
And he was in a lockdown.
Because of a gun incident. Yes?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yes. There was shooters that had robbed a jewelry store, and the off-ramp they took was right there at Cal State Fullerton. And two of the shooters, at least, maybe two shooters, were running around on campus. And this lockdown lasted for a long time, and they weren't getting proper information. And my son kept texting me, I wrote this up on the blog at the time. And finally, there was confusion. Their teacher abandoned them because he had other things to do. He wasn't, it didn't seem to be too worried. And he ended up calling everybody and apologizing because he was required to the next morning. Anyway, so his classroom ended up in another classroom where they were locked in. His classroom originally had no way to lock themselves in. Nobody had a key to lock the door because the teacher left.
Oh, my God.
And so they stayed in this other room, and finally they left on their own, even though they weren't given the go-ahead because nobody was answering questions, and their building was pretty far away from what they found out was the really big danger zone. And so they walked all the way around campus because they were not allowed to walk through campus.
Oh my
they found
God.
Somebody's car that they, could give them a ride home, and they got home that way.
Oh, my God.
I don't even ask. And between that and my dad, so I called my dad last night.
Uh-huh.
My dad is the one who's deteriorating. He's 94 now. He's about 94. He's going to be 94 next month. And he's had a series of strokes, and he's just been going downhill mentally. Physically, he's still fairly healthy, but mentally, he's a mess. And what was even more disconcerting was I called him finally last night, and I said, he watches the news. I mean, he actually, is aware of a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, did you watch about the Boston thing? Well, he was so out of it last night. And I said, well, do you know that, your grandson was there? And he didn't remember he had a grandson last night.
Aww.
Which was the first time that's happened. So it was not a good day. I was not having a great day yesterday. I'm very glad it's a new day, and hopefully he'll be a little more alert today, and I'll talk to him
mm-hmm.
about it.
Oh, my God. There's so much more. Oh, you know what I do want to do? I want to bring up the audio, of the president's address. So as soon as that. So let me bring that up. But your son is now fine, and he's back at school today, I guess, and
I don't know. I didn't talk to him this morning because, I'm up before dawn when
mm-hmm.
I do your show. And
right.
I don't talk to him usually until daytime
or
nighttime. So I'll find out. But he was at a friend's. So first he had to get home.
Oh,
he didn't
God.
Have any car. So someone has to drive him home, or he has to take a cab. And I guess he has school.
Okay. Well, in a few minutes, the president is going to address the nation again. So we'll hear what he has to say. In the meantime, there were so many stories that you had for us to talk about today. And about guns, there's that one that I spoke to Cliff Schechter
yes.
about, that Alan Gottlieb guy. This is pretty frightening. And especially there's going to be an open amendment process on this bill, this gun bill, if it gets to that point. And, I know they're going to try to jam it up with a lot of things, as this guy said, to make it a pro-gun bill rather than, a gun safety bill. And I hope that the people who are pushing aren't just trying to get just anything done, and they will make sure that if the pro-gun shit outweighs the gun safety stuff, that they knock it down.
I know. I'm looking at what Think Progress reported, which is part of my post, and it says other pro-gun advocates are still pushing for an amendment that would further weaken the bill, override tough state laws, and force all states to recognize concealed carry permits. I mean, those are just no-goes. These are so self-defeating. For any Democrat, anybody to vote for this, because they're in the pocket of the gun industry, makes me literally physically sick. When you watched what happened yesterday, you watched the mayhem and the death.
Yep.
Well, you know what? There were a whole lot of people that have, thousands who have died at the point of a gun since Newtown. And that doesn't matter to them. It has to be a big group bloody scene for them to get bothered.
I know. And now, by the way, of course, there had to be some gun incident this morning. A Temple High School in Texas is on soft lockdown after a student shoots himself and is taken to the hospital. I guess the kid's not dead, but a student shot himself. And, I don't know what the fuck we're coming to.
That's what went through my mind. That is exactly what's been going through my mind. It is as if every passion from every side has surfaced, whether it's good, bad, or indifferent. You know, there is no indifferent passion, but you know what I mean?
Yes.
Whether it's good or bad. They have come. Yesterday, I was called a C-word and a whore by some porn star on Twitter who has a good following because I reported that MSNBC had said that these were indeed bombs that went off yesterday before the bomb word was used, right? They'd used the bomb word finally.
Right.
And then I amended my tweet and I said, okay, that was a quote from somebody in Boston who's saying that, not MSNBC saying that as a report, you know. So I followed it up honestly within a second of when
Here's the president. Hold on. Let's listen. Hold on. Come on.
By my national security team, including FBI Director Mueller, Attorney General Holder, Secretary Napolitano, and my counterterrorism and Homeland Security Advisor, Lisa Monaco, on the attacks in Boston. We continue to mobilize and deploy all appropriate law enforcement resources to protect our citizens and investigate and to respond to this attack. Obviously, our first thoughts this morning are with the victims, their families, and the city of Boston. We know that two explosions gravely wounded dozens of Americans and took the lives of others, including a 8-year-old boy. This was a heinous and cowardly act, and given what we now know about what took place, the FBI is investigating it as an act of terrorism. Anytime bombs are used to target innocent civilians, it is an act of terror. What we don't yet know, however, is who carried out this attack or why, whether it was planned and executed by a terrorist organization, foreign or domestic, or was the act of a malevolent individual. That's what we don't yet know, and clearly we're at the beginning of our investigation. It will take time to follow every lead and determine what happened, but we will find out. We will find whoever harmed our citizens, and we will bring them to justice. We also know this. The American people refuse to be terrorized because what the world saw yesterday in the aftermath of the explosions were stories of heroism and kindness and generosity and love. Exhausted runners who kept running to the nearest hospital to give blood and those who stayed to tend to the wounded, some tearing off their own clothes to make tourniquets. The first responders who ran into the chaos to save lives. The men and women who are still treating the wounded at some of the best hospitals in the world, and the medical students who hurried to help, saying, when we heard, we all came in. The priests who opened their churches and ministered to the hurt and the fearful, and the good people of Boston who opened their homes to the victims of this attack and those shaken by it. So if you want to know who we are, what America is, how we respond to evil, that's it. Selflessly, compassionately, unafraid. In the coming days, we will pursue every effort to get to the bottom of what happened, and we will continue to remain vigilant. I've directed my administration to take appropriate security measures to protect the American people, and this is a good time for all of us to remember that we all have a part to play in alerting authorities if you see something suspicious. Speak up. I have extraordinary confidence in the men and women of the FBI, the Boston Police Department, and the other agencies that responded so heroically and effectively in the aftermath of yesterday's events. I'm very grateful for the leadership of Governor Patrick and Mayor Menino, and I know that even as we protect our people and aggressively pursue this investigation, the people of Boston will continue to respond in the same proud and heroic way that they have thus far. And their fellow Americans will be right there with them. Thank you very much. And you can expect further briefings from our law enforcement officials as the day goes on. When we have more details, they will be disclosed. What I've indicated to you is what we know now. We know it was bombs that were set off. We know that obviously they did some severe damage. We do not know who did them. We do not know whether this is the act of an organization or an individual or individuals. We don't have a sense of motive yet. So everything else at this point is speculation. But as we receive more information, as the FBI has more information, as our counterterrorism teams have more information, we will make sure to keep you and the American people posted. All right? Thank you very much, everybody.
I guess that's it. No questions and no information.
No, that's just what I was thinking. It's just sort of the same thing, but I guess it just it's letting everybody know what we don't know.
Right. Well, and now he called it terrorism, which he didn't do last night. But I'm sorry. Any time that people are terrorized, it's terrorism. I'm sorry. Guess what?
Yeah.
Newtown was terrorism. That shooter. I know his name, but I don't like to say it. It was a terrorist. That's terrorism.
Of course. Of course.
That's what kind of terrorism.
And any person of any color and of any nationality should be considered when we're talking about this instead of targeting, I'm just... that goes back to this guy. So I was telling you this guy was calling me all kinds of horrible names because I had done a two-part tweet and explained it. And he accused me of trying to get the news out first so I could have bragging rights.
Oh, God.
Which was like the last. I mean, I was like, "What?" And then I'm thinking. So is he getting on the right wing guys who are accusing this is going to be a Muslim attack?
Right.
Is he jumping all over that guy too? And then Anthea Butler, do you know her from?
Oh, sure.
From
Twitter.
She DM'd me and said, "Yeah, you know what? This guy follows me, and I don't know why. And I don't know if he does this randomly where he attacks people like he just did you, but very strange." You know, I said, "Yeah, I don't know." It was totally uncalled for. I certainly don't follow him, and he doesn't follow me, so I wasn't quite sure why he was on my case. But anyway, so this goes to all the craziness and the passions out there that are so irrationally expressed at times, and then you step that up one more and you get a bombing like this.
I just saw a few people who said, let's stop the speculation. We do not know. We don't know if it was, an Al-Qaeda operative or a terrorist sympathizer or a white extremist group or a skinhead. We do not know. So let's wait until we know. Look, I do think that because of all of the, there are video cameras everywhere now. And they know where the bombs were. That I guess they were in trash cans in front of two hotels. I mean, there's got to be videotape of it. I can't imagine that it's going to take them too long. But what do I know?
I don't even try to think that far ahead. I literally take it as it comes to me. And then I even take that with a grain of salt. Like when you were reading the CBS reports about the airplane.
Right.
I was kind of like, yeah, whatever.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, it was interesting, but I was like, you said the same thing. You said, yeah, let's wait and see.
Right.
You know?
Right. Well, that's what you
it's
have to do.
It's interesting, but okay.
And, so Susie Madrick. Now, she said, saw a news item on Twitter that the plane was stopped for that reason. Because, I asked, they were overheard speaking Arabic, probably not anything. Where did you hear that? She knows better than that. I love Susie, but yeah. See, we're all just like grasping at things. Oh, my God, right?
Right. Well, I think it's also ridiculous to make an argument about which words the president uses. I mean, if he does use the word terror or terrorism.
Right.
I hate when people use the word terror instead of terrorism, by the way. But it just terror is an emotion and terrorism is an act. So what if he, I understand that he's parsed to the nth degree.
Mm-hmm.
But come on, that's not what's important here.
What's important here is
preventing it and dealing with it right now.
Right. Well, and finding out who did this, I think, is important.
Exactly.
And getting it right.
Right. Here. But back to this guy. Okay, so Alan Gottlieb. Cliff was a little bit reassuring when he takes what this guy says with a grain of salt. This is the executive vice president of the Second Amendment Foundation and head of the Citizens Committee for the Right to Keep and Bear Arms. who spoke at this GOP event. It was in Oregon. It was at the Persimmon Country Club. And he was telling everybody, ha ha, gotcha fooled. We snookered the other side. It's a pro-gun bill. Neener, neener. I really am glad to hear Cliff, who knows a lot about a lot, mm-hmm. no matter what he says, and who's a personal friend of mine, so I can yep. tease him all I want.
Right.
He was reassuring, saying, this guy's known to lie. All right, good. But he made sense when he said what he was lying about then. He made sense that they were trying to pull a fast one, and his words, we hung a million ornaments on the bill. We're making it a pro-gun bill. Some of my colleagues haven't quite figured it out yet. This will probably break on wall. Okay, this is inside baseball. I can't justify morally. Here's another quote. I can't justify morally that a person who walks into a gun show, buys a gun from somebody without giving his name, the guy can hardly speak English, and he walks out the door with that firearm with no check, nothing at all. So he's assuming that somebody who doesn't speak
English... Right, that's his concern, that somebody who doesn't speak English can get a gun. That's his only concern. So maybe, you know, just have a written test.
Yeah, that was disgusting. And he does say... earlier on in his speech that if somebody sold a gun to somebody who's misused it, nobody can sue you even as in a civil court for damages. That's great protection that you don't have right now. I wonder if that part's true or not in the bill.
I don't know.
That's what we'll have to find out, I guess.
Yep.
But anyway, as Think Progress said, this is not a group that has had a sudden change of heart. You know, this is not somebody who's supporting the background check bill because suddenly they've decided that we need to be protected. They
right.
want that gun industry to keep selling guns.
Well, my only, you know, the only good thing, I hope that, you know, Mayors Against Illegal Guns and other pro-gun control groups will read this thing. And if the, the NRA types start getting more, more stuff that they want in there, then... you know, then we'll help our side, then they kill the bill.
Yeah. Well, I just wish that people would stop worrying about how much money goes into their damn pockets and what political gain they can accrue here and start really worrying about the people who they represent. It just boggles the mind.
Good luck.
How corrupt our system has become and has been for some time.
You know, my head is about to explode, Laffy, because this thing just came across my Twitter stream again. So the plane that was surrounded, where they took people off, that was a U.S. Airways plane, because I saw the live video of it. And that had something to do with luggage, right? That was the plane that came in from Philly. Okay, it had something to do with a bag that was not properly checked, right? And so that's what that was. They said it had nothing to do with the marathon. But now... And I have to say, this comes from the Boston Fox affiliate, myfoxboston.com.
Okay.
The headline is, plane brought back to gate at Logan Airport. And it reads, sources told Fox 25, there. And remember, we heard some said it was an American Airlines flight, and some said it was U.S. Air. Apparently, there were two planes. Sources told Fox 25 there was an American Airlines flight that was headed to Chicago. There were two men on that plane, not sitting next to each other, and speaking Arabic. There were some concerned marathoners on the flight, so the plane was brought back to the gate, and the two men were escorted off the plane. No other details were immediately available.
For speaking Arabic?
Yep.
That's nice.
Because people
Yay,
were concerned
America!
On the plane that these two guys were speaking Arabic. So there you go. And in the comments, this is interesting. The first comment I see is some woman who said, if the bomber ends up being a white guy, does that mean I get to kick all white men off a plane because they make me feel uncomfortable?
Thank you. That is exactly right. There was the people who have been doing these shootings that we're talking about. What color are they?
Right.
Right. Okay.
And let's look at the other, incidents that have happened historically this week, between April 15th and April 20th, right? Today's a Virginia Tech shooting, and that guy happened to be, I think, Vietnamese, if I remember correctly. He was Asian.
Yeah.
But Timothy McVeigh, the Columbine kids, the Waco, right? Jared Loughner, the guy from Aurora, the guy from Newtown, they were all white men. Yes, and Jazz Cat Trio is asking, are there signs on the plane now that read English only?
See, that's it. It's profiling galore. It's awful. And yet, you know, we really haven't had much discussion overall of what you and I are talking about, and that is that most of these guys are white. You don't hear that. You everybody concentrates on the racial profiling. It's mind-boggling to me. How can you prevent future crimes when you're not willing to accept past ones?
Yeah,
look who the perpetrators are.
Right. I know. And so this did happen. You know, as apparent. So this did happen. There, that a plane at Logan, and people were taken off because they were speaking Arabic.
That's just unbelievable. Unbelievable.
I'm shocked. Hold on.
Well, if they were pulled off for no reason, I wonder if there'll be some lawsuits that
follow. Right. Absolutely.
If
as
it were
there
me,
should be.
Yeah. Just
now,
bad.
Again, it is a Fox TV station reporting this, but this article sounds reasonable or not reasonable. Like the story's not reasonable, but the story sounds real, and it backs up the other reports that we heard.
Yeah.
And the thing with American and US Air, and that's why the confusion with the two different airlines.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. We'll just see if it pans out.
I know.
My heart's beating like 1,000
I know.
Beats a minute right now.
This is fucking crazy.
And meanwhile, I'll bring this up. This is one of the things I sent you that John Kerry was saying on CNN. That
right, here, let me play. I'll play the audio. I've got
good.
Here.
Okay,
here's
great.
John Kerry. Just listen to this snippet of this interview.
There is a major debate on guns. Do you hear in other countries where you have visited, any concern about that debate?
I've heard in a couple of quiet conversations with a few officials is two things. Number one, how safe it is over here in this country where people are not running around with guns. And number two, how some students, we had an interesting discussion about why fewer students are coming to particularly from Japan, to study in the United States. And one of the responses I got from our officials, from conversations with parents here, is that they're actually scared. They think they're not safe in the United States, and so they don't come.
Wow.
Yeah, and there were other reasons, of course, that they didn't want to come. That was one of the reasons. And so I got a tweet immediately after I posted that on Twitter, that somebody said, somebody who, you know, is fine, no, not a crazy right-wing person at all, said, that's BS. Please. You know, and I'm like, well, no. This is what he heard directly. This is not rumor. This is not speculation. This is what he actually heard on one-to-one conversations. So, yes, they look at our record, and it's growing. And they're seeing that there's more violence here, and some of them take place on college campuses. So why would they want to come to our country if they're worried about all that violence and our laws and our terrible system of trying to enforce laws and you name it?
Right. No, I hear you. I hear you. I got to say, look, I tweeted out, apparently second plane incident at Logan, Arabic-speaking men were pulled off flight. And Empty Wheel, Marcy Wheeler, I love her, wrote,
I love
"Unpossible.
Her, yeah.
The president just told us Americans refuse to be terrorized."
Yeah, we're tough that
yes,
way.
I know. It's impossible. So that's that. Then, you have Marco Rubio. Marco Rubio, who the inept idiot who wants to be president, is on Meet the Press, and you know he did the whole full Ginsburg or Monty in his case, showing that he has no
None.
Penis. Here he is with just an inane conversation with David Gregory here about gun legislation.
We have, for example, concealed weapon permits across this country. I have one. These are people that are pre-approved in terms of getting concealed weapons permits. So perhaps there's a way to accommodate that across all 50 states where a concealed weapons permit is treated as a de facto background check. But ultimately, if the reason why we are doing this, if in essence we are spending all of our time talking about background checks as if somehow criminals will no longer get guns because they have to undergo a background check, we're lying to people. That isn't true. The fact of the matter is that we have a violence problem in America. Guns are what people are using, but violence is their problem. And no one is having a debate about the violence problem. And I think this is a missed opportunity to have an honest and open conversation in this country about why these horrifying things are happening. Not simply what they're using to carry this out, but why are people doing this to begin with? Senator, and all the focus is on laws that only law-abiding people are gonna follow.
You know the political analysis right now as a prospective 2016 nominee. You've got to be careful not to stray too far from the Republican Party on guns, particularly when you're stepping out and trying to be a leader on immigration. So you got to pick your areas where you're going to stand out.
Well, David, I disagree with that analysis. My position on guns is the same they've always been. The Second Amendment is a constitutional right. I didn't write that into the Constitution. That's in there. And any time that you're going to do anything that impacts a constitutional right, the scrutiny should be very, very high. And that's what I'm applying to this. If someone can produce a law that keeps guns out of the hands of criminals but protects the right of law-abiding citizens to possess them and doesn't infringe on those rights, I would consider that. But the proposals I've seen so far, now I haven't fully read the Toomey-Manchin compromise, but all the proposals I've seen so far do not achieve that goal.
Now, I haven't really read this thing, but it doesn't achieve the goal. You know that because you haven't read it?
Exactly. Well, there are so many things in what you played that drove me absolutely crazy. One was, well, the criminals aren't going to obey the laws anyway, so why have the law? So why do we have laws? Why do we have a constitution? If you're going to run a red light anyway, we don't need red lights, you know? You're going to sell drugs anyway. We don't need drug laws or whatever. You know,
why bother? Why bother to have laws against setting bombs at at public places, setting off bombs anywhere? Because there are people who are going to break the law.
Yeah, they're going to do it anyway. We don't need any laws because people are going to disobey them. Okay, the other thing he was saying was, and anytime you're going to do anything that impacts a constitutional right, blah, 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 this does not impact a constitutional right in any way, shape, or form.
Nope.
It's a false argument. It's irrelevant. It has nothing to do with the Second Amendment. And yes, Jazz Cat Trio is right. What a total ass Rubio is. Now, that might break a law, Jazz Cat Trio, so you better watch out.
You're right.
But anyway, oh gosh, there was something you said just before all this that, he hasn't read the Toomey-Manchin.
Right. But he knows it, doesn't do the trick. It's not good enough.
It's so good. Okay, I wrote a post, and I mentioned this in the post that I wrote about this, about people who look at headlines that I post or that other people post, maybe they're blog headlines or maybe they're real headlines, and they only tell a tiny part of the story. A headline will either give you a quote or a little come on or even something funny. It'll just give you something that tells you what the subject matter is and pulls you in so that you can read the details. That's why they're called headlines, right? So people constantly base their judgments on only that. That's what he reminded me of. He said, I haven't read the bill, but I'm gonna opine about it anyway.
Right. Well, that's what he does.
Yeah.
That's what he does. That's Marco Rubio. He's an empty suit, who happens to be a Hispanic American. And so, look, just as they, a youngish Hispanic guy, person of color, and because that's what they think they need. And so, Bobby Jindal started, after he came off looking like Kenneth the Page doing his State of the Union response, well, they went to the next guy in line, and that's Marco Rubio. There's no there.
Exactly right. And they've actually come out and said in the past week that they're going to try to put more women and people of color out in front to be their spokespeople so that they can appeal to people that they want to vote for them. So they figure if they paint a pretty picture and say a couple of new words, that they're going to suddenly have a big open tent that everyone's going to be swarming into. Well, when you have an idiot like Rubio who represents what they hope will attract voters, and he continues to say idiotic things, then they're either going to attract really idiotic voters, which they already have in their party, or they're not going to attract anyone, and they may repel people.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, they are repellent.
Yeah.
That's what they are. You know, you had this other story that I found so repulsive that I need to at least play part of it. I pulled down the video because it was unreal. In we all heard about this bill in Tennessee that would tie welfare assistance for needy families to their children's grades in school. Unbelievable. Look, as someone who, you know, my kid struggles with school, I can't even imagine if our, you know, assistance that we need as a family were tied to her grades. And what kind of pressure does that put on kids? It's disgusting. Well, this guy, he's a state senator in Tennessee. His name is Stacy Campfield, and he's the one who introduced this bill. Well, I guess it was, I don't know, one day last week. A group of people went to his office to deliver a petition with more than 2,500 signatures on it to protest the bill. And so a mother was there with an 8-year-old little girl. The mother is founder of a local child advocacy group. And so they go to deliver this petition to this guy. And I'm going to play some of the video and the audio. You'll hear at the beginning, of it. Oh, okay. Hold on. Let me pull this.
I've got it.
Okay.
I've got it.
All right, so all these people are walking out of the office, and finally the state senator comes out, and you see the little girl that's about to come. Okay, here, no, is this the guy? You'll in just a second. Here you go. So the guy comes out, he walks over to the little girl.
I love it when people use children as props.
I love it when people use children as props, he says.
She has something to say. You are so weak to not listen to a child.
And he's walking away saying, I don't use children as props. And he keeps walking.
She has something from her heart she wants to tell you.
I appreciate it coming down, but I don't use children's props.
And it goes on like this for the next 4 minutes. He's walking away. They get in an elevator with him. And the only thing that this jerk off says to them is, I don't use children as props.
With a smile on his face.
And then, I'm not going to make you sit through four of this. Towards the end of the video, there's a guy there who was one of his constituents who tries to talk to him about the bill. And this guy, Campfield, calls him, you're just a union thug.
And the only reason the guy got to talk to him like that way was because they were in an elevator.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm hearing myself.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, okay. they were in an elevator together.
There was a whole segment where they all follow him into an elevator, and he can't escape from these people at that point. So
right.
Then the adult man who spoke to him, who was called a union thug, was able to get a few words in. But what killed me was he's going, using children as props, as he's using a child as a prop to make his point.
Right.
That he doesn't. I mean, he gets in this little girl's face, this sweet little girl. She had such a sweet little
right.
face. And he gets right into her face and says, I don't use children as props. You know, and bullies her, basically. He's bullying her and her mother. And this is the way he treats the people who he's hoping will support him. Well, how can they possibly support a bully and somebody who uses a child as a prop to make his point against children as props?
Yeah, it was just so reprehensible. This guy is a piece of shit. Well, bottom line is he actually wound up withdrawing that bill because he couldn't get enough support from, you know, his own Republican colleagues.
Right, right. But so, he's going to try something different. You know,
well,
he's one of those.
But it's not going to work, obviously. I mean, even that was too heinous for them.
Right. No, this was just, it was despicable what he did. And to dismiss one of his own constituents to his face, right in his face, yeah, union thug, yeah. He called somebody a thug for speaking his opinion to his representative.
Mm-hmm.
He called a little girl, a prop.
To her face, and kept saying it over and over again, because the little girl was in the group that was following him.
So that's what this girl's memory is going to be, this mm-hmm. big face smiling literally inches from her little face, calling her a prop.
Yep, yep. It's pretty disgusting.
I bet he had bad breath, too. Ha-ha. Yeah.
All right, and on that note, gotta laugh. Find her at thepoliticalcarnival.net and here on Tuesday mornings. You know, I'll see you on the Twitters, and we'll keep, you know, updating when any real information comes out. Hopefully they get some, you know, leads and figure this out quickly.
I hope so.
And, you know, prayers if you pray, and thoughts and good energy going out to, you know, the 170 some odd people who are still in the hospitals, and the 17 who are in critical condition. We will end today with the anthem. Thanks, Laffy. The anthem of Boston. All right. My town. I'll see you tomorrow, radio or not. Bye, everyone, and sing along.